What's good, everybody? Welcome back to the Midday Live Show. We're live with episode 19, and I am so excited. I think today is, even though it's cold outside in Chicago, very cold. It went from like 70 to 20 in like 24 hours, but that's Chicago, right?
No, that's bogus, man. Let me tell you what's been going on, man. So it was 50 degrees last week. Mm-hmm. 50 degrees last week. I thought it was over with. I'm thinking I'm about to get sexy, you know what I'm saying? I'm about to take my shirt. I've been working out everything, right? Let me tell you, I'm at work last night. I thought it was sweet. Mm. I walked outside about 8 o'clock. Boy, I almost cried. I seen them thick crystals coming out the sky. Boy, the wind got to blowing. The temperature dropped about 20 degrees. Boy, everybody started slipping and sliding, bro. And I said, God.
Tragic.
I can't believe it, man. We back at wintertime all over again.
I know. But I feel like we're going to be out of it soon. So hopefully it'll get warm and stay warm.
It's so cold that the whole Major League Baseball is doing a whole boycott because they just don't want to play in this. And I don't blame them.
Really?
I mean, that's not the reason, but it might as well be.
Okay. Now, let's not spread fake news. Steve, what we got going on? We have our first guest in the waiting room, Miss Lynn Banks. Let's give her an introduction.
Yeah, absolutely, guys. Definitely. To tie into that weather, don't stress, because tomorrow we got, you know, lows in the 27s, but right afterwards, we're going to be in the 50s and the 60s for a whole week.
Ooh, okay. I'm here for that.
A little bit of dirt, you know, a little bit of stress, a little bit, you know, let's get over the hump. We got this.
Well, we got this, bro. I hope the best, man. I don't believe it, but I hope for it.
But without further ado, you know, welcome to the Midday Live Show, where we make sure we entertain, we educate, and of course, we want to inform. Have a great time here, guys. We have a great guest. Her name is Miss Lynn Banks, you know, the founder of Icon Island, a content creator herself, but I also see her as a director of promotions, and she offers a music management services online. So, guys, let's give Miss Banks a warm, excuse me, Mike went out.
We
a
know
nice,
what you mean.
Warm round of applause.
Woo, woo.
What's up, Ms. Hey, how's it going? Thank you.
Good,
thank
how are you?
I appreciate the intro.
For sure,
I'm good.
For sure.
I'm also, you know, cold as hell up here, so I feel you guys.
Okay.
The struggle is real.
All right, well, Ms. Lynn, we're going to get straight to it. How you doing?
I'm doing good, you know, doing good. Can't complain too much, you know.
All right, that's good.
Wouldn't help anyway.
My name is Jarrell, you know what I'm saying? So nice to meet you, you know what I mean?
Nice to meet you all too. Pleasure, thanks so much for having me on.
Of course.
Oh, it's more than a pleasure. It's our pleasure. It's our pleasure.
Well, thank you, thank you.
So you've been in the entertainment industry for a minute now.
Yeah, 10 years.
10 years. Can you take us back to before year 10? What inspired you to want to be in this industry?
Yeah, I mean, I come from a very tiny island in Canada. So, you know, where I come from, there wasn't a lot of opportunities, but I always loved music. I knew I always wanted to be in the music industry. I just didn't exactly know what I wanted to do at that time. So I thought, you know, I got to move to the big city, start somewhere and kind of see where it goes. And then over the years, I've kind of found what I'm good at. I found my skill set, you know, what I'm passionate about. And I just went full speed in that arena, so.
Like to hear it.
Love to hear it.
So, like management is your game, right?
Honestly, mainly marketing. Marketing is really my game. Digital marketing is what I specialize in. You know, I've helped lots of artists blow up on TikTok, grow their fan bases, book shows, all that kind of stuff. But I do manage an artist, Jay Vans. I'm developing him. He's the only artist I'm kind of focused on right now. But otherwise, you know, the marketing agency, I get to work with lots of artists, you know, indie artists and majors. So it's an exciting thing to be into, you know?
No, I definitely know. And I know there's a lot of perks to being the marketing person also. You get a lot of connections. You get invited to a lot of places, stuff like that.
Yeah. I mean, it's been weird with the pandemic because, you know, some places have a lot of stuff going on and then other places don't have a lot going on. I was just down in Miami for a month with my artist and it's like they never even had a pandemic. You know what I mean? But then you come back to Canada and it's completely opposite. So it definitely has its perks. And, you know, for me, I really enjoy traveling. So that's a huge part of it. What I love, you know, one of the biggest things that I love about it too, because I just love seeing the world and I love seeing other cities, especially in the U.S. is so interesting to me that every city has its own like community of music, its own sound, its own style, its own thing that it's kind of dominated and like sort of specialized in. And I think it's really interesting, you know?
Nah, definitely. Yeah. I know you mentioned though, like every city has their own kind of flavor, like a different, but do you see a difference between the industry in the States versus Canada? Is there a huge difference?
Oh yeah, massive difference. So like we have a ton of talent here in Canada, but there's not the right infrastructure the way that there is in the US, right? Because if you look at the biggest artists in the world, like Drake, The Weeknd, Justin Bieber, Shawn Mendes, they're all Canadian. But they didn't blow up in Canada.
Yep.
They all left Canada, went to the US because the US had the structure to actually turn them into superstars. You know what I mean? But it's crazy because when you look at their teams, like everyone on their team, like their producer, their manager, their this, it's all Canadians. So the talent is in Canada, but then we have to go elsewhere because I just think that you guys have a bigger population. And I mean, you guys have dominated, the US pretty much has dominated the music industry for much longer than we have. So we do have a lot of labels and stuff like that here. But I mean, if you sign to Sony Canada versus Sony US, it's a big difference of what it's going to do for your career, you know?
I'm sure.
Yes. I wasn't even aware that there was a Sony Canada or a Sony.
Yeah.
Sony.
We got a few things.
Canada low-key has the juice. Low-key.
No, a lot of people don't know.
No,
it's true. Like, there's actually a ridiculous amount of talent here. Like, it blows my mind. Like, every time I go to Miami, they're like, oh, man, Toronto people are always coming down here. They're so talented. I'm like, no, for real. Like, there's lots of talented people. But, you know, we do have to go elsewhere to really kind of take off, you know?
That makes sense. What would you say is the most rewarding part of your job?
Honestly, I love being a part of the creative process and seeing a song go from like an idea and a concept to like a fully finished record to getting out to the world and then the impact it has on people. You know, I'm working on a song right now with my artist called Anxiety, and it's wild to see some of the impact it has on fans and how people are commenting like, this song saved my life. Like, thank you for this. Like, I lost a friend to suicide. Like, really the impact that music has on people, because I think all of us have a special place for music in our hearts, you know? And I think music impacts everybody differently in a different emotional way. And for me, being able to deliver that music to the right listener and see the impact it has on them, that's, for me, that's like a really special thing. So that's what I like the most about it, to be honest.
Yeah, I think almost in all aspects, but especially with the entertainment and the music industry, I think leaving a positive impact on somebody is something that we all want.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's definitely really rewarding.
Yeah, I think a lot of people might not be in the game for the right reasons, but the people who are in it for that reason, those are the people who are going to go far, you know?
Exactly. Yeah, it's like you can't worry too much about the money or like clout. There's too many clout chasers out here. Like, worry about putting a positive impact on people's lives.
Yeah, and here's the thing, clout has an expiry date, you know, because trends are always changing and things are moving so rapidly on the internet right now that, yeah, you can jump on a clout, a trend, and be popping for 6 months, but it's going to expire eventually. So like you said, if you focus more on the impact you have on people, you will go way further and you will have a 10-year career in this game versus, you know, 6 months to a year and then everyone forgets about you, right?
Yeah, exactly. One-hit wonders, they call it. Or, they were popular for like a month or two and then I forgot about them.
Yeah, exactly.
So piggybacking off of what you just said about lasting 10 years rather than like 6 months or however long, what advice would you have for an artist for longevity?
I think that artists need to have more of a long-term vision, I think, and have a game plan and approach things with a mindset of like, what value do I bring to the table and what is this person really going to help me do and what can I help them do, you know? Because I think a lot of artists a lot of the time are a little bit desperate in a sense to like get their music heard or get seen or get a signed deal or whatever the case may be, but I think that that sort of anxiousness when they approach the conversation, it comes off in the wrong way, and then someone who could really help you get to the next phase or get where you want to go isn't going to take you as seriously. So I think having like a long-term vision for yourself, having integrity and knowing who that person is and like what they do and if they can help you or not, because, you know, I might meet you and I might be like, oh, like you're in hip hop, I'm in pop. I don't know if we can do anything for each other, but let's just build a friendship. And eventually down the road, maybe there might be synergy, you know? And I think a lot of people dismiss people who might not be of value to them right now, but it's like, you don't know down the road if that person might be able to help you or be in a position to help you. So it's like, just build real human connections and relationships. And eventually, like, that's going to get you to where you want to go, you know?
Yes. I like to say here on the Midday Live Show, say that again for the people in the back that didn't hear you the first time.
Yeah, human Those connection is everything, you know? Yeah, people forget, I think, because we spend so much time online, we approach things now, like, as if we're talking to someone in the DM, but it's like, that's not real life. You know what I mean?
Right.
And I tell people, you got to flip that script and talk to someone in the DMs like you would to them in real life. Like I tell artists all the time, I'm like, face them, you know, really analyze how they're DMing people. I'm like, bro, would you walk up to someone in the club and she's like, yo, check out my music? It's like, no, that's super aggressive and you would never do that in real life. That's so awkward, you know what I mean? So same
right.
DMs, like, if you come at someone like that in the DMs, it's not gonna work. But if you came here like, hey, how's it going? Boom, there's an instant human conversation, because that's how you would really approach a conversation in real life, you know? And that will literally get someone to actually respond to you and to want to talk to you versus like all the spammy bullshit, you know?
Y'all better listen to Lynn out here. All these artists, listen, she is dropping gems. She's trying to let y'all know the game.
Right, yeah, so that is definitely big sauce right there.
Lynn, check it out. Check out, I need a little advice, right? I'm an artist. Yeah. I made a song that me and my friends, we think this is the one. This is the one we gonna go with.
Yeah.
What's the next step from going from the recording studio? What's the next, as a marketing person, what would you say the next step is to blowing that song up?
Yeah, so the biggest gem is like content right now. Content is king, you know? From videos to photos to promotional content, content is king. And a lot of artists think nowadays, like, we're extremely lucky that we're in the era we are of technology, because back in the day, even 5 years ago, like, if you didn't have a bag, you could not blow up. If you didn't have someone backing you in a bag, like, just don't pop up. But nowadays it is, like, artists can really be creating video content surrounding their single and pushing the story and posting it on TikTok and growing a lot of fans and a lot of buzz organically without really spending a dime, to be honest. And then if they do have a budget, they could be putting budget on top of what they're doing organically, and then it could go even crazier. And the cool thing about TikTok content is you can take that TikTok video and you can multi-purpose that video. You can use a little app on your phone, remove the TikTok stamp, post it on Instagram Reels. Boom. Now you have two pieces of content with one video that you did one time. You could post that on Twitter. You could post it on Facebook. Like, you could repurpose that so many different times. Cause like, even my own artists, we've had a video we posted on TikTok, it only got 1,000 views. Then we posted it on Instagram Reels, 10,000 views. And vice versa. We've had videos do insanely well on TikTok, and then we post on Reels and it doesn't do anything. So you just never know who's watching when or where. So the more you're posting on every platform and utilizing these opportunities that you have with social media for free, you're gonna see a lot more results than anything, you know? Like, I tell people all the time, like, I'm not a magician, I'm a marketer, you know? I can't make you blow up if you don't give me good content. Like, you have to give me good content that people are gonna vibe with and relate to, and then I can make shit happen. But I can't pull a rabbit out of a hat, you know what I'm saying? Like, if you don't have content, I can't make people fuck with you. Like, people are visual nowadays. They want to see something. Mm-hmm. They want to connect with you. And if you don't have that, then you're selling yourself short, you know?
Nah, definitely.
100%.
Do you ever find yourself, like, creating content strictly for the algorithm, or kind of creating your content around what you think the algorithm is going to like?
So here's the thing, the algorithm is a computer. It's an AI generated computer software. So nobody really knows what the algorithm wants or what it's gonna like. But the thing that you can track and tap into are trends, right? So I tell artists all the time, like, if you're brand new to TikTok and you're like, I don't know what to do on TikTok, go on TikTok as an artist, find the top five trending sounds, and then be like, yo, this trending sound, I could go in on this record. Like, I can make a remix to this and make it go crazy. Put your own spin, unique spin. Don't just do a cover, literally make like a remix to that trending sound. And that could get you a million times further because now you're getting in front of the entire audience that's using that trending sound. And then people are gonna see your unique talent because you took a song that they love and then you made a dope remix to it, you know? So you can do little things like that, that, like you said, is not essentially tricking the algorithm, but it is putting you into a trend, you know? And that can help. Like another good example is, I've been telling artists to hop on this wave and like, I don't know why they're sleeping, but like duets are massive on TikTok. So you have artists like Russ. Russ is a massive artist, you know what I mean? Like huge. He's doing duets on TikTok and saying, here's an open verse, do a duet and jump on this hook, right? You could duet that song. And if you kill it and you do better than everyone else, keep picking the best duet and releasing the song on Spotify and streaming platforms. So you literally have an opportunity to do a collab with Russ for free just by delivering your best lyrics on a song. And you could blow up literally instantaneously off of a fucking free feature with Russ. Like, that's crazy, you know? And like, exactly. Once again, what does that take? Your time and your effort. That doesn't take any marketing dollars, you know? It just takes you putting in the work, going on TikTok, looking at the trends, looking at duets. Like that first duet Russ did went crazy. And that girl he picked to put out the song with, like the song already has a million streams.
Wow.
You know, so.
Shout out Russ. I love Russ.
Yeah, love and Russ. He's super talented, you know? And I like that he's given artists an opportunity. And he's, even as a big artist, like you don't see Drake on TikTok. You know, but to me, Russ is just as big because he has a super cult fan base. You know, he could sell out stadiums on his own, no problem. So for me, I admire him so much more because I'm like, you're so smart because you already have a fan base, but you're going to grow even more fans and stay more relevant and gain more buzz by being on TikTok, you know?
Right. It's like you have to use the platforms that are given to you.
Absolutely. And I mean, listen, TikTok in the history of music is pretty much the only opportunity artists have ever had to be discovered. Really and truly, there was no other discovery platform. Spotify and Apple are not a discovery platform unless you get put on a playlist, which is very difficult because there's like 50 spots on New Music Friday. You're competing with 50 spots from major label artists to artists are trending on TikTok to all of these artists. Good luck, you know? So. And are you really getting discovered by being on that playlist? Probably not. I don't really see a lot of people being like, oh, I got added to New Music Friday and then I grew 1,000 fans. Like, it's just gonna grow your streams, which is great. It's gonna get you heard, which is great. It's gonna build relationships, that's great. But to build that fan base, that Russ fan base, you need to be on a discovery platform, and that's what TikTok is, you know what I mean?
Most definitely.
For all sure. Right. Oh, no, I was going to pass it to Mr. Steve Stylez.
Yeah, thank you, guys. Appreciate it. Thank you, Lynn, for joining us. Another round of applause.
Absolutely.
Great. Good, yes. Good energy. Great.
Thank you.
Absolutely. My question to you is, behind the scenes, you know, how does one get into marketing themselves if they're curious enough to start?
Yeah, so I think if you want to get into marketing, it's just about being interested in the field that you choose. So, for an example, if you want to choose music marketing, you just have to really do a lot of research and stay, you know, ear to the ground type of mentality where you kind of see what's going on as it's happening versus 6 months after it's kind of ending the buzz phase and the trending phase. And I think if you're the type of person who is really passionate about it and you can do your research and stay on top of the trends, you can be a good marketer, you know, because that's what it's about. It's about understanding what's working right now in this market at this current moment and not what worked 6 months or a year ago, you know?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And I see a plaque behind you. Can you tell us a little bit about that plaque you got on the wall right behind you?
Oh, yeah, my million streams plaque.
Excellent. Yeah. Well, congratulations.
Thank you. My artist that I signed, I developed him for like a year. We dropped an EP and I got a million streams on it. So, you know, thought I deserved to throw a plaque up on the wall.
Definitely.
Absolutely,
do.
You do.
You
absolutely.
Are way too humble. Yeah. Way too humble. Let me have thank a plaque you, like that. Oh my gosh. You are way too
yeah, it's good. It's for me, it's just a good reminder to like show yourself like how far you've come and like what you've been able to accomplish, you know? Because a lot of people are like, oh, I don't want a plaque. And I'm like, I think it's like like, you know, if you win an Olympic medal, you hang it on your wall. Like, you're not going to hide that in a box. Like, you know, you got to be proud of how far you've come, right?
Yeah. Checkpoints, you know, in that game of life, I guess, you know? Yeah.
Yeah.
That's so cool.
Appreciate it. Yeah. But where can our viewers, our we get a lot of entrepreneurs, self-starters and creative content.
Yeah.
People here on this channel. So where can they reach you if they want to maybe get in contact with you and maybe check out your services that you have to offer?
Yeah, absolutely. You can hit me on Instagram at Icon Island, or you can check out my website, icon-island.com. And I'm pretty much on every social media app. And I do check my DMs very aggressively. So if you ever DM me or email me, I'm on it same day.
Aggressively in the DMs.
I can attest to that.
Yes.
For sure. Jasmine's on it too. Can we say aggressive, Jasmine? Aggressive in the DMs.
Yes.
Get it. Yeah. That's what's up. That means you're punctual, you're precise, and you treat this like a business. And to all my creative businesses out there, hit the like button. Shout out, Meech. We see you.
Hey,
I see
Meech.
You, Meech. Meech is saying he's following you right now, Lynn.
Thank you.
Awesome sauce, man.
Hit that like
button. You know, we got videos coming out every Friday, you know, here on the Midday Live Show.
Absolutely. So if there are no more questions, I want to thank you again so much, Lynn Banks, for joining us today on the Midday Live Show.
Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, of course.
It's been amazing.
Yes.
Yeah, you are just like so full of knowledge. That's what I knew. I was like, we have to get her on the show. We have so many artists like needing this knowledge. So I knew. I got to go to the expert.
Yeah, listen, I'm always open to share because, you know, at the end of the day, I think if you can give someone a little nugget that could help them get ahead, like, why not, right? There's enough room for all of us here.
Most definitely. And if you got to plaque this show off, you know what I mean? You show it off because that's inspirational. Man.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Of course. So we will talk to you soon and have a great day.
Thank
everybody. You again.
Thank you. Take care, Lynn.
Bye, Lynn.
Appreciate it.
Wow. Miss Icon Island herself. So make sure you guys follow her on all social media platforms at Icon Island. It is right below on the ticker. And Miss Ma'am got some gems for you, our artists out there. So make sure you're listening. If you didn't take any notes, I'm going to need you to watch this back later on and then jot down some notes.
Yeah, definitely. And if you missed this episode or you just want to grab us wherever you get your podcasts, keywords are going to be the Midday Live Show, Spotify, iHeartRadio app. Download it for free today.
Download it for the free ski.
$3.99.
Ooh. Jinx. You
owe me iced tea.
Oh, yeah. I forget you say that.
That's what
so
I say.
You're so healthy.
I love it, though. I love it.
Hey. But how about a weather report, guys?
Oh yeah.
It's gonna be a report for sure.
He's like, it's gonna be depressive. It's not gonna be nice.
Yeah. It's not. But Johnny, roll the clip anyway. Sick of this.
What's up, Chicago? It's your weather update brought to you by Young Street Gear. So check out the jacket I'm wearing. I'll tell you about it later after the weather report. Chicago, it's currently 34 degrees out night. It's brisky. We got miles at about 12 miles per hour is what I'm gauging right now. You know, and tonight it's going to be cold in the 15s. And don't worry, guys. We got one more day like this. Tomorrow we're going to have lows of 27. So it's going to be another cold day. But I'm telling you, by Sunday, we're going to be in the 50s and the 60s all week long. And if you want to be prepared for this type of weather, especially the weather here in Chicago, get yourself some Young Street Gear, all right? All you got to do is type in Young Street Gear in whatever search browser you got, and the first couple links are going to be mine. Get yourself something today. Support the channel. Support the show. Back to you guys.
For sure, man. Hey, look, Young Street Gear going to have to get some swim trunks or something, man. I'm taking my shirt off this summer.
Yeah, for sure. Well, we could start at like shorts, maybe. How about that?
You kind of just went to an extreme.
It's all good.
I'm just saying, the weather here is extreme. You see what I'm saying?
You're right.
Weather be more bipolar than my mama. You know?
Yeah. Ooh. Stay ready, ain't gotta get ready. Cause I remember they had these pants too, like in the late 90s, where they had the zippers by the knees.
Oh yeah, so, that was the late 90s.
Yeah, was it the late 90s? Yeah. So you'd have to unzip. And you turn your pants into shorts.
My gosh. I do remember those.
That was like 03 for me. I got a whooping for wearing some of them when I started sagging.
Yeah, right.
That bipolar shit did quit.
Stop throwing shade at your mama.
She know
her. That is funny. But you know mama. What else is funny? It's time, y'all. What's time? Jazz's joke of the day.
Here we go.
All right. So, everybody, listen up. Why don't cheetahs play poker? Wow, I just messed it up. Wow. Hold on.
Hold on. What?
Hold on. Because I didn't give the answer. Okay.
What just happened here?
She was laughing at her own joke in her head.
I was. Okay. Why don't they play poker in the jungle?
Because they be bluffing?
Because there's too many cheetahs.
Oh.
Get it?
That sounds like college for me.
Yeah, see?
Cheating?
Cheating like crazy. Cheating in the classroom, cheating in the bedroom. It was wild. It was crazy.
Sips tea. Sipping tea. College was quite an experience, but we ain't even about to get into that.
Mm-hmm. Especially if you went to a bootleg HBCU like I did.
Not a bootleg HBCU.
Well, everybody know SIU Carbondale been a bootleg HBCU.
That's like an honorary HBCU.
That's what I'm trying to tell you. Bootleg, honorary, whatever you want to use. Y'all know what it is.
It be like that.
Shout out to my Carbonites out there.
Carbonites. Nice.
I was one of them. I ain't go home for the song.
Okay, he was out there being a hot boy. Period.
Still a hot boy.
Hot boy.
Don't we know it? So does the hot boy have an inspirational message for the folks today?
Always.
Always.
Okay.
What's cracking, you dig? You know the voice, you know the vibe. It's your boy Jarrell, and we back with another inspirational message of the day, you dig? I ain't gonna talk too much. We're gonna keep it simple today, you feel me? Look good, you feel good. My pops used to always tell me that when he wanted me to tuck my shirt in, you know what I mean? You look good, you feel good. You see what I'm saying? I'm gonna tell you something like this, bro. You wake up in the morning, man, you fix your bed, you clean your room, you mop your floor, you take your garbage out, bro. You put yourself in an environment where you can succeed, you feel me? Cleanliness is next to godliness for a reason, you feel me? When you got a clear environment, you feel good, you look good, your house look good, your car look good. I'm going to tell you like this, you feel good. When you feel good, you spread that energy to other people, and that's what's important. You see what I'm saying? You look good, you feel good. You see what I mean? Clean environment, clean thoughts, you know what I'm saying? Clean hygiene, meaning you giving all clean energy to the atmosphere, G. God, I tell you, bro, everybody knows somebody that don't look good. And I guarantee you, that person don't feel good. I guarantee you, that person ain't bringing no positive energy to the atmosphere. So I tell you like this, you feel me? Sometimes you got to get swaggy, you feel me? Sometimes you got to look at the weather and be like, oh, that ain't going to stop me today. I'm looking good either way. Because when you look good, feel good. You see what I'm saying? That's your voice real. That's the inspirational message of the day. You did. Remember, I told you first.
Hey, I got to agree with that because I think, of course, all the women out there can agree with that. Because when our hair isn't done the way we like it, when the eyebrows not looking right, when the lashes looking bogus, when the nails aren't done, we feel like we just look like crap, you know? And it's like we don't exude that positive energy in the universe because we feel it some type of way.
Exactly.
You know?
And I hate when women don't, you know, I feel good. You know, that bothers me on the inside. I got so
but then that's why we're here to uplift them, my man. Isn't it?
Yes. And they uplift me with their good looks.
Yeah.
We just bounce energy everywhere. It's just,
it goes back and forth, man. You know what I'm saying?
Hey, that's the circle of life, baby. Ain't it beautiful? Hey.
You better say that on International Women's Month. Shout out to all the women out there.
Shout out to all the women out there. All of them.
Yes.
All of them.
All of them. Okay, they heard you.
Hit me in a DM, you know what I'm saying? All of them.
Anywho, I think it's about time we take a little break, a little music break, a little commercial break, and the Midday Live Show will be right back. Don't go anywhere.
Oh, I'm on fire. It's a billion degrees in here. We'll be right back.
side. What a lovely day to leave and drive into the sunset. Made a lot of memories, but haven't had much fun yet. I wouldn't take that as a negative, just have a higher life to live. And when you see what I have planned, you will forgive. You can bet I'll do my best to fight for you and I. As long as you always keep your eyes up in the sky. Make a mistake by thinking that the shit they say is fake. Until one day you hit with the light shining through and now you're awake. Feels like not long ago, there was pink in the afterglow. Not a cloud in the sky, and the color from the moors like a sunset in July. Feels like not long ago, there was pink in the afterglow. Now the blue, it's so blue, and there's nothing I can do except look in the sky for you. I'd like to get that vitamin D so deep inside of me. But the man is wrong, no way he clean out a sheet of blue. Snipe, definitely control the weather through the frequencies I tether, and I'm strumming all my harp and making harmony to bring us all together. Rise above until it passes, carefully convert the masses. Soon I'll be teaching classes with the lesson that surpasses all the information that's broadcasted. And I know that once they all get a taste of it, I'm flabbergasted. Feels like not long ago, there was pink in the afterglow. Not a cloud in the sky, and the color from the moors like a sunset in July. Feels like not long ago, there was pink in the afterglow. Now the blue, it's so blue, and there's nothing I can do except look in the sky for you. Never been the one to really blow it up or make a flash. I do my part, really make the music, so I'm making cash. Executing like a calculator, be a hater. I ain't moving from the spot, so I guess I'll see you later, alligator. Here to make a change, and I got my eye on the ones. Okay with status quo, let it go, that's not the line to toe. Dog and pony show. I'm just waiting on the after our entertainment. Yeah, that revolution that's on me, you know you can't defame it. Feels like not long ago, there was pink in the afterglow. Not a cloud in the sky, and the color from the moors like a sunset in July. Feels like not long ago, there was pink in the afterglow. Now the blue is so blue, and there's nothing I can do except look in the sky for you.
You know, everybody has a problem.
What do you mean?
With my milkshake.
Huh?
So they can hear you. They probably heard our whole conversation.
Oh my.
You know what? Hate to see it.
We'll see on Spotify. We'll see on Spotify. Well, what's up, everybody? Welcome back to the Midday Live Show. It's your boy, Steve Stylez, along with the best dream team you could imagine. You know, if you were to take, like, you know, Mike, Kobe, and LeBron, you'd make the Midday Live Show. You know what I'm saying? We just got legends in their own right.
Period.
You know,
as
we
long
got.
As I'm not LeBron. I'm with that.
Hey, who do you want to be then? Who's you go? Right, who's going to be yours? You, Kobe, right?
Yeah.
You, Kobe? All right, cool.
I like that. Mm-hmm.
How about you, Jarrell? What are you? Who are you going to be?
I'm going to be Jarrell.
Of course you're going to be Jarrell.
I'm the LeBron of this microphone thing.
That's right. All right.
Okay.
Like, bro, when people put the headphones and a microphone on, they go, Jarrell. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm me. Where's you? I'm the king of this right here.
Okay.
They go, Jarrell.
No, yeah.
She's already doing it.
Same thing when they drop their phone, they're like, ah, Jarrell.
Yeah, I mean, they need to drop the phone, but sometimes they belch and they go, oh, Jarrell. You know what I mean?
All right. Well, my bad for trying to, you know, compliment all three of us in some form of analogy, like the Three Musketeers. You want me to do that? Los Tres Amigos. You want me to do that? Some like that?
Oh, yes. Or we can be Amigas Cheetahs.
You can't just be the big three.
Amigas Cheetahs. I like that better.
It's the Cheetah Girls, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
No. No.
Why not?
We are not sisters. Mm-hmm.
We can be Cheetah brothers and sisters.
We can be the Cheetah fam.
Huh? Okay.
For sure.
Cheetah fam.
Cheetah fam. But we're not cheetahs, though, you know?
Hey, we keep doing this. Cheetos gonna reach out to us, boy. We gonna get us a flaming hot sponsor.
Right.
On me, we definitely could be the Cheetah family then.
Brought to you today by insert brand.
Insert brand name here.
Whoever has the biggest check. I didn't say that. Whoever supports the show.
Anywho, but no, for real. Big shout out to TDP, Rap a Lot Midwest. Trust the process. We are live from the Rap a Lot Midwest studio.
Yes, we are.
It's episode 19 of the Midday Live Show, and I'm telling y'all, you don't want to go anywhere because coming up in about 5 minutes, we have a very, very special guest straight out of Power Book 4, Force, Mr. Anthony Fleming III, that plays J.P. Gibbs, a.k.a. Tommy's brother. And man, this season has been crazy.
So crazy.
Ooh.
You've been enjoying it?
I have. I really have. Tommy has always been one of my favorite Power characters. So I was waiting for him to get a spinoff. I was just waiting.
Man, this is...
But this is different, though.
Yeah,
especially for people that's in Chicago.
Yes.
This is way different. Way different. Did anybody see the last episode?
I did.
My man took a shot at Tommy.
He did.
Everybody know that train. You feel me? Everybody know that. You go out west, you ride down Lake Street, you got that train up. Man, they took that shot at Tommy, that little drive out of that train. Wow. I said, God, I just was over there yesterday. Wow. That's so cool, man.
Yeah.
It's wild.
I love watching shows that are based in Chicago, and you like just try to peep all the locations that they're at. Like, oh, I know where that's at. I've been there.
I had a thought. All of the George Floyd riots and everything was going on a couple years ago, and I remember all of the streets was getting blocked off. They were shutting down downtown, all of that, right? And I can't help but kind of think they were shooting Power the whole time. That's why they were shutting everything down. I'm tripping. Every time we look up, it's another scene. They right downtown. They on Columbus. They on Wacker. They on Lakeshore Drive. I say this is what they was doing the whole time.
Hey, they were definitely all over the place. So, never know.
Man, I love this. Love this. Next time, they're going to have me on the...
Okay, let's just put the whole Midday Live Show on there. Why not?
Hey, it'll keep it authentic, baby. Keep it authentic. Yeah,
period. Big shout out to Javier. That's our boy.
Yeah. What's up?
But man,
that's what it is, man. Season 2 of Tommy, man. Tommy and Jarrell. That's what it is. What if we could get Tommy up ahead? That'd be amazing, wouldn't it?
Hey, you know, I'm not ruling it out.
Sakura.
You know what I'm saying?
You know my pronunciation,
man. I
know. That's why I'm like, what?
I don't know.
Segura. Doesn't that mean like something in Spanish?
Seguro?
Or I'm thinking of another word.
Well, you could say like seguro or segura, I guess. It could be car insurance or insurance. Seguro. Yeah.
So, yeah.
No, but ever since you guys put me on to Power 2, you know, like I've been watching it, man. Like Tommy's my spirit animal. I swear.
Really?
That is my
love
guy.
It.
Eesh, man, just
my
good
boyfriend
time.
Feels like that too.
Mm-hmm. Oh man,
like
no,
Tommy
but
is his spirit animal.
I'm not saying like I've done what he's done. You know, I've done some things, you know, similar to that. So it's crazy, but I'm
so
older.
If you were a character, you would be Tommy.
Oh, for sure.
I could see that though. I could definitely see that.
Who would you be, Jazz?
That's a good question.
Who would you be? Mm-hmm. Most like your personality.
Because it's like all the women in Power and some of the spinoffs, it's like they all are not quite like me. But I think the closest to it maybe would be Lauren from Power Book 2.
Yes.
I think the closest.
Yes. Yes, it is.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Except she got God. And I don't plan on getting God anytime soon. So.
Did she get God though?
I think she did get
I don't
God.
Know if she got God.
I think Alex was like...
I feel like, and I might be ruining something, but what I realized about Power, if they don't actually show the person getting murdered, they not dead.
So, okay, let's open this conversation. Because I'm a firm believer that Ghost is still alive and he's going to come back at some point in these spinoffs.
That'd be awesome.
He took a shot to the heart. He was out of there.
But what if...
What if what?
What if he didn't die, though?
Nah, he out of there. He out of there.
What makes you think so? Just because we saw it? But what about the funeral? They never opened the casket. So.
You got something.
That might have been a fake body. It might have been empty. Like.
Man, it could happen.
You never know.
I think he's still alive.
You never know. Because I swear Kanan was dead when he was burning in that house. And you know what I'm saying? That's why I don't know what to believe no more.
He definitely came back with a vengeance. He was real mad. He was big mad.
Thought Lobos was gone. He came back. He was like, bro, I don't know what to believe no more.
Yeah. Lauren might just come back. You never know.
If I was a character, though, I'd be Tariq. Easy.
You would be Tariq.
Easy. Sometimes I look at his character and I go, that's the exact person that I am. For real, for real.
Y'all relate? Y'all here?
I mean, he went a little bit farther than I did with it, but like, yes. Yes, 100%. Like, you want to talk about a kid who was privileged but still came up around all of these influences and he ended up a result of all of them? Yes. Yes.
Okay, I see where you're coming
100%.
From. 100%. I smell what you're cooking.
I understand the life of Tariq, even though a lot of people don't get it. I fully understand it. Fully understand it. It is what it is.
Pray for him.
I wouldn't have let my little sister get shot, though. He tripping.
Still can't forgive him for that. Yeah. That hurt. That was a hard episode to watch. For real.
That was a rough one. That was a rough one. I ain't like it either.
Super sad. But anyway, let's end our power talk and let's move on to another power talk because we have our special guest waiting in the room. We have Mr. Anthony Fleming III. He is an actor. He's a voiceover artist, but you have most recently seen him in Power Book 4, Force, as JP Gibbs, aka Tommy's brother. So please, everybody out there watching and listening to the Midday Live Show, please help me in welcoming Anthony Fleming III to the Midday Live Show. How are you?
Hey.
Yo, what's up, good people? I'm doing good. How y'all doing?
Amazing, man. Amazing, great, man. Great.
Dig it, man.
So we just gonna, you know what I'm saying, jump it off, man.
Come on.
Let's get into it.
Love the energy, Anthony. Love it.
How did the, like, casting director find you and like pick you for this role, man? Because I don't think they could have had a better person play.
Hey, thanks, Jay. I really appreciate that, man. Actually, Joseph Sikora found me. Joe and I have been friends, man, for about 20 plus years. We've actually worked together in theater in Chicago. So, you know, Joe called me up and said, you know, Anthony, there's a role coming up in a show of mine that I think you'd be great for. So he said, yo, do you mind if I slide your number to one of the EPs? And at the time, man, I wasn't working. I had been retired for like 2 years from performing. So I was like, hell yeah, slide him my number.
Okay.
So he called me up and that started the audition rolling. You know, I had to audition probably about 7 or 8 times. But luckily, thankfully, I was able to finally lock the role and be JP Gibbs on Power Book 4 Force. Join that Force family, that Power family.
Okay.
You know something?
Some people know.
That makes so much sense. Because when y'all on the screen, y'all do have a genuine brother-like chemistry. Yeah. And now you're telling me that y'all pretty much are genuinely brothers. Y'all been cool way before Power, you know?
Yeah, man. We was cool way before that. You know, we've been in plays together. You know, we've challenged each other on stage, and you know, you can't, Joseph always says, you know, you can't fake 25 years of knowing a cat, you know,
right?
And luckily that's able to be seen on screen as well.
So speaking of the theater and being on stage, can you tell us a little bit more about the start of your acting journey to present day as a series regular?
Wow, my acting journey professionally started in 1997. When I was 19 years old, I was in my first play and I portrayed a brother named Fred Hampton, who was a real life person. He was a Black Panther in Chicago in the 60s, a real powerful, dynamic cat. So that was the first role I played. And I was in college at the time, but unfortunately I had to drop out of school. But while I was doing that one play, I got cast in another show. And I was like, yo, I got to drop out of school, but I'm gigging, you know, I'm doing what I want to do, which is great about, you know, coming up in Chicago, you know, being born and raised here and coming up in theater here in Chicago. There are so many opportunities to really work on your craft and hone your skills. So I just did as many plays as I could, you know, and tried to learn from everybody that I was working with, all the great artists that I came in contact with, all the directors, other actors like Joseph, because there's so much talent here in Chicago.
Yes.
A lot of stuff y'all watch on TV and in film, a lot of them cats, a lot of them artists, they come from right here. So indeed, it's great to be able to showcase not only our city in Power Book 4 for us, but the great, great well of talent that we have here. So, you know, I've done mostly theater in my career, almost 25 years now. And, but I've done some TV and some film, and like, you know, TV shows would roll through Chicago. I would audition for them. Like I had a recurring role on this show called Prison Break for a couple of seasons. And then I did like some Chicago Fire stuff, but mostly theater. And I would tour around doing theater. I work with a company here in Chicago called Looking Glass Theater a lot. I'm an ensemble member there, and also a new board member with the theater. And then they do a lot of physicality with their storytelling, a lot of circus work. So they add that element of kind of spectacle to our storytelling. But 3 years ago, I felt that I was done. You know, I was coming off tour of a show, and my body was kind of hurt a little bit from all the physicality. And you know, when you're on tour, you're away from home for like 6-8 weeks at a rip. And I, you know, the older you get, I was like, man, I'm tired of being away from the crib. You know, I want to be at home with my family and around my stuff. So I laid it down, and I had picked up another career doing, because I've always had a side hustle. You know, I was a bike messenger for 12 years. I was a bouncer at a nightclub. Actually, Sakura and I worked together at that nightclub in Chicago. So, you know, I was a group fitness instructor for 5 years, and that was taking off for me, teaching classes, you know. So I decided to hang up acting. But, yo, COVID came through and wiped all that out. You know, it shut down the health clubs in Chicago and probably in your city, too, you know. So I was essentially unemployed for about 2 weeks trying to figure out the next move, you know, what the next hustle was. And then my phone rings, and it's Tommy Egan. Wow. You know, so that's how that came about.
So first of all, your whole plethora of things that you have been a part of are just amazing, and personally, and all three of us, we are so proud of you, and we love watching you on screen.
Oh, thank you so much. That really means a lot to me. Thank y'all.
Of course,
most definitely, man. You got a little nickname around the city now, man.
Oh, what is it?
You know him as the guy that brought a bat to the gunfight.
Yeah, they be clowning me on that, man. I love it though. I was just in the sneaker store, and one of the homies walked in and was like, "Hey man, why you bringing a bat to a gunfight?" Like, yeah, man, I know, man.
No.
But that's just how cold JP is. That's all he needs, baby.
No, that's okay, right, that's right. Let him know.
You know.
I just like to hear that, you know, COVID sound like it was really a blessing for you, man. It sounded like it was just supposed to happen.
Man, it really has been a blessing, the way the whole thing came together. The audition process was real tough, man. I ain't going to lie. Because one, I was like 2 years removed from performing, and even longer than that from on-camera stuff. So, you know, I had to get those chops back. And then the audition process, because of COVID, was all done like this over Zoom. So I was so used to, you know, getting in the room with the casting directors and having them feel your energy in the room. But I had to let all that hopefully translate through these computer screens. But luckily, I was able to grab that. And it just felt like this whole process has felt like, you know, it was mine for the taking. You know, it was like this role, I feel. One is the dream role. And, you know, like Jarrell said, I just feel like, yo, can't nobody play this but me. Sometimes as an actor, you come across those roles where you read it and you instantly feel like, this is mine. I'm the only one who can portray this and tell this story.
Yeah.
You just can't wait to add your skill and really craft and develop this role within the story. And luckily, I was able to do that. I mean, JP, he's so layered, you know. He's definitely more than meets the eye. I know he's been on kind of a slow burn for the first half of the season, him and Tommy, because, you know, Tommy got to figure this cat out. You know, Tommy got to figure out, can I trust him? So I think once that starts to be established a little bit, you know, we'll turn up the gas a little bit, and that slow burn will simmer and start to bubbling, and we'll get to definitely see some stuff. But JP is a cat who, you know, he definitely has a dark side, and he's got some secrets like everybody does, like Tommy does. But now Tommy and JP, they're about to tell each other, you know, what's really going on. Coming up in episode 6, coming on this Saturday on the STARZ app, and hey. Sunday at 8 p.m. Eastern, baby. I know I'm going to be tuned in.
Man, you know I watch that too. Every week. That's my show now.
Indeed, man. Oh, yeah, mine, man, as well.
You're like a cultural icon. Power is a mm-hmm. cultural phenomenon, man. And that's pretty cool, man.
The power. The fans in the Power Universe are some of the best fans in the world, man. They've spent so much time and invested so much energy into these characters and into this story. So it is an honor to become part of this family and to continue telling the story. You know, and the natural progression of it is Tommy Egan. What happens when he breaks ties with New York? Now he's in a whole new city, setting up camp, ready to just rule. You know, he's a king, mm-hmm. ready to rule in his own city for the first time without all those New York beefs, without all those New York, you know, situations. And there's a line, and I think it's in the second episode, where he says, he's talking to Gloria, and he says, you know, she's asking him, what is it about this city? Why don't you come back? And he just says, I don't know. It just feels like I can breathe here. And I definitely feel that with Tommy. He's able to breathe. And I mean, not only is he kind of, I mean, the original reason why he came was to, like, you know, kind of bury some open wounds from his past. And then when he gets here, you know, he finds out, you know, things is different than he thought. You know, his grandmother is still alive, and one, you know, he's got a brother from the same mother that he knew nothing about,
right?
You know, so he's setting, he's, you know, getting to the bottom of that, but then also setting up his reign here in Chicago the way that he wants to. And it's so great to be able to watch that, to be able to watch how Joseph Cora has come, you know, full circle and really stepping into his power in this series. You know, this is definitely Tommy's show. And it's great to see it in real time.
I can only imagine. Yeah. So what has been like a very memorable or even your favorite part about filming with the cast and the crew?
How focused and dedicated everybody is. Everyone knows the importance of what we have. You know, when you have a show like this mm-hmm. that is so beloved by so many people, I mean, literally millions of people. Did y'all check that premiere? Our premiere broke all kind of records, you know. 3.3 million people tuned in to watch.
Jeez, wow.
You know, that faded the show on Showtime. The Dexter premiere, that faded the show on HBO by a lot. That White Lotus joint. So it's a huge, huge show, man. It's a smash hit. And when you have something like that, there is a responsibility as a performer. You want to do it justice. You want to give your best effort. And everybody showed up every day to work and just put forth their best effort. And it was great to see, to be in scene with Joseph and all the other cast, and to watch how everybody got down, to watch Isaac Keys and Chris Lofton do their scenes, you know, to watch Tommy Flanagan mm-hmm. work, the legend Tommy Flanagan do his stuff, the ladies, you know, Lily and Gab, you know, to watch them work, Guy Ben Swearingen, my man who plays my son, you know, D-Mac, Lucian Cambridge,
yes,
and his homeboy, Ahmad Ferguson, you know, two young cats that are just, look out for them, y'all. They have so much talent, and they are so hungry, and they're just going to bring so much to this series. So it was great just to see everybody. One, we had a good time. One, we had fun on set. Second thing, I was at home, you know, so I was waking up every day and basically going in my backyard to go to work, you know. I was like 20 minutes from the set, so that was dope. And it was just great to be a part of the whole process. Like I said, I had been retired. I stepped away from all of this. So to come back on such a project with such a heart and such pulse, so many great people and directors, and a show that is written so beautifully, Courtney Kemp and her team, and to have, you know, Fitty, who is the architect of this whole thing, putting all the pieces in place, and just to see it become what it's become. It was just great showing up to work every day. It really didn't feel like work. You know, it was just an honor to tell this story. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We appreciate that so much, man, because, like, the people here in Chicago, the media people here in Chicago, we haven't had something that really, like, was able to connect to since Empire was the thing, you know, back to 2013 and 14. Mm-hmm. You know, back then it was cool to be able to say, hey, I'm going to college with this person and they an extra in Empire, or I know this person that know this person that's in Empire, and that, like, you know, maybe 10 years later almost, you giving us that feeling again of, you know what I mean, this, I know this local guy, now he's on the biggest TV show in the world. And I appreciate that.
Love
so much,
to see,
man.
It.
That's so
thanks.
Cool.
Thanks, Jay. I really, you know, for the premiere, I like to tell this story. You know, it was a bunch of my family. We were sitting in my living room chilling, watching the premiere, like y'all, bunch of Chicago cats. Mm-hmm. And that first scene when they show our skyline, you know, you in unison and without anybody saying anything, everybody just lifted their glass and was just that swell of pride. You know how we feel in Chicago, man. When you from here, you love being from here. You love telling cats, "No, I'm from Chicago." You know, you love when our city is shown and when we're represented in such a beautiful light. So it was just so dope. It is so dope to see every week, you know, different shots of the city. The city is such a part of the show. And the way New York was a big part of the original series, Chicago has its own flavor. You know, Chicago's a big city, but Chicago is not New York. We got our own thing here and our own flavor. And Jay, that was the dopest thing about going to set. You go to set and you would see actors, you know, who would have a day or had a recurring role, and you're like, "Yo, I did a play with that cat like 5 years ago. You know, that cat played my dad." The guy who plays my dad on the show, Herman, he's a brother named Cedric Young. Talented, talented veteran stage actor. I mean, if you saw this cat on stage, he'd peel your wig back. I'm telling you, a powerhouse brother. He's also an ex-Chicago firefighter from back in the day. So to have him on screen, to be on screen together with him, just showcasing Chicago's talent, you know, Joseph Sikora himself from here, you know, right. Chris Lofton from here, God Ben Swearingen, who plays Paulie Pierogi, from Chicago, and just a litany of crew, directors, everybody on set, you know, working to make this show what it is, just repping our city. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing.
Definitely, man. Definitely, man. I know you had mentioned earlier today that you did a lot of theater.
Yeah, man.
So has Power kind of like shifted your acting style, what you like more, to the screen, or do you still got that passion for the stage?
Always the stage, brother. I love the stage. You know, I cut my teeth as a performer on stage. You know, I developed into who I am as an artist on stage. You know, 24 years on the boards, that's a long time. And I've worked with so many great people and learned from so many great directors, Ron O.J. Parson, Dennis Zajac. I've worked with so many, you know, David Catlin. I've worked with so many great actors on stage, A.C. Smith, Cedric Young, who plays my dad, you know, Larry Newman Jr., who recently passed away here in Chicago, just legends who I've learned so much from. You know, they're the reason why I'm here, you know, and it's on their shoulders that I stand. So to be able to come and, you know, do Power is great, but I'll always have my roots in theater, and I'm excited about, you know, since this show definitely has pulled me out of my retirement, I'm definitely excited about getting back on stage very, very soon.
Oh, that's really good.
Almost as excited as about season 2, which just been announced, right?
Yes.
Yeah, baby.
Big
season 2 is going to be twice as nice. We're coming back for more. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing, y'all. So look out for that. I can't wait to get back to work.
Oh, yeah, we waiting.
Man, I can't wait to patiently, maybe be an extra. How about that? We may have to make that happen, you know?
Okay.
I hear that. With a name like Steve Stylez, man, you need to be on there.
Got to, brother. I appreciate that. Yeah, you know, yeah. I had a quick question for you too, Anthony.
Talk to me.
Being a performer, being a man that, you know, has been knowing what to do at an early age, did you have a moment maybe in your life growing up that you realized that, hey, you know, I am the performer, I am the guy that's, you know, going to be on stage with the limelight? Did you have a moment like that growing up?
Yeah, man. It's when I was 9 years old. I was 9 years old in fifth grade, and we were doing a play called Huckleberry Finn. And everybody in the fifth grade had read the book. It's a Mark Twain book. And I had to play the bad guy because, you know, I was the only black kid in school. So they was like, "Yeah, you the bad guy." But I was like, "All right, that's cool." So I remember I totally got into it, learned all my lines. I wore my costume all day in school. The play was at the end of the day, and I wore my costume all day. Even before school, I went back into the backyard of my dad's grill. I got some charcoal, and I rubbed it on my face and hands because it was a real grimy kind of cat.
Oh, man.
And when I stepped out on stage, y'all, I remember everybody in the cafeteria booing loud, full throat boos.
What?
Because I was the bad guy, but yo, I loved it.
Yeah, that's, you're supposed to boo the bag, boo the bag, the bag.
Exactly. Bag.
So you're doing your thing.
Right. They booed me before, yeah. I made them feel like that before I even said anything. I was like, if I can get this reaction out of people by just stepping out here, it really, I don't know, it did something on the inside of me because I was a really shy kid growing up. You know, I was kind of to myself. I had a little bit of a speech impediment, so I didn't really talk much, especially to cats I didn't know. You know, so I kind of kept to myself. And, you know, my sisters and I were like the only interracial kids in the schools we went to. So, you know, I ain't had no a lot of homies, but doing this show and that reaction I got from people, it just immediately broke me out of this thing, man. And I felt myself opening up. I still remember that, you know, all these years later, I still remember that moment. And I was like, yo, this is what I want to do. And I've never really wanted to do anything else. I wanted to be in the NBA for like 10 minutes. I thought maybe I could make it. When I was in eighth grade, I thought my crossover was pretty dope. I thought I had a shot, but it didn't work out.
Oh, well, you got. Yeah, go ahead real quick. But
what's up?
It's on me, bro. My bad.
Oh yeah, absolutely. My bad.
Yeah.
Oh okay.
My bad.
It's a little rough, man. My next question was which do you think is more difficult? The theater or the screen? Because I know you mentioned like the boos from the crowd. Yeah. And I know when it comes to the screen, it's take one, take two, but ain't no audience, you know what I mean? So which one you think is more difficult?
I mean, they're both difficult, but in different ways, you know? Film and television is definitely not easy. You know, big respect for all the artists, you know, putting together TV shows and movies. You know, it's artistry. It's a really involved process. You know, you're shooting out of order a lot of the times. And there's just a lot of things to consider. You know, theater, you're sort of working to fill this space, you know, a big space. You know, I would do shows with like 1,000 people in the house or whatever. So you have to hit that back row. You know, that back row got to feel you just like that front row feel you. But when you do TV, you know, in TV, you work in right here. That same feeling, that same energy, you have to be able to put that right here without blowing people out, you know? So it's a different type of, right. You know, in theater, the response, the feedback you get from your storytelling is immediate. You know, you feel it in the audience immediately, whether it's a laugh or a cry or a gasp, whatever. So you feel that as a performer, you hear that and feel that from the audience. Where in TV, a lot of times it can be like working in a vacuum. Like you do it multiple times from multiple angles, multiple ways. But, you know, a lot of times you don't know how it's going to look. You don't know how it's going to look until after it's all edited and put together. So there's that. But I would say they're both difficult, but in different ways. And, you know, I love them both. You know, I love them both. And I learn from doing both. And both of them make me a better performer overall.
For sure, man. I'm gonna keep that in mind myself, man. You know what I'm saying? It's here with it.
You gotta be here with it, you know.
All right. Cool, man. So 27 years, huh?
Almost 97. So what was that? That was about 25 years ago, man.
25 years.
My first.
If you could go back to 1997, Anthony, what's the one thing that you wish you would have known back then that you know now?
Wow. That's a great question. As far as acting?
As far as acting.
Man, just, you know, the perseverance that you need, you know, and to keep working. A lot of times people think, you know, when they see an actor on a show and it's successful and they like it. I mean, there's so many times when that actor has failed, you know, There's so many times when that actor was told no. Instead of yes, we hear no way more than we hear yes as performers, you know.
Right.
We audition for stuff and go for stuff, and you know, the majority of the time, most of us are not getting it. So that's why when you do get something that hits and that is successful, you know, you really try to live in that moment and embrace that. But I would just say, you know, it's a marathon, not a sprint. Sometimes when you're a younger person, you know, you want everything now. You want the success now. You want to hit now. But you really have to put in that work. You really have to ask yourself, what is my dedication to this craft, you know? And you have to ask yourself, which is something that I've had to do many times, you know, when I was younger, you know, do I want to be a movie star or do I want to be an actor? And those are two different things, you know?
Okay. Yeah. So perseverance, patience.
Definitely.
Yeah. Great skills. Great skills we can all apply, you know, toward our other choice careers that we do or even everyday life. Man, thank you for that one.
Indeed.
Awesome. Well, last question I had for you. I just want to know if you remember, which I'm sure you do, what was your reaction when you found out that you booked the role of JP?
Oh, man. I was with my family. I was with my kids and my wife. And that same producer who I was telling you about called me up and on FaceTime and was like, yo, Anthony, what are you doing from February to August next year? And I was just like, hopefully working on Power Book 4 for us. And he was like, we'd love to welcome you into the family. And I mean, it was life changing. It really has been. And I knew that it would be. I knew that the role that I was lucky enough to be able to portray was going to have an immediate impact within the Power universe. And I was so thrilled and happy. You know, leading up to the announcement and the audition process, you know, I was sort of preparing myself. You know, I'm a big runner. I love to trail run. So I spend a lot of time in the woods here in Chicago running off road. And when I'm able to, I travel around a little bit and do some mountain climbing, you know, in Tennessee and Colorado and other places that I dig. So spending some time in those mountains and, you know, by myself with this meditation and just, you know, I was sort of preparing myself. And I could honestly, as corny as it sounds, yo, I could feel that it was coming. So when the announcement finally came, I just felt like, yeah, you know, it reminded me of my grandmother who recently just passed away, but she would always tell me, you know, she lived in 96, beautiful woman, lived a beautiful, beautiful life. And my spiritual mother, she just always told me ever since I was a shorty, you know, she would say, you know, grandson, God has a plan for you. And, you know, her faith in that, she believed that even in the times when I didn't believe that, you know, it was like, yeah, okay. But her faith in that, you know, was something that I always love and remember. And, you know, she's right. She's definitely right. God does have a plan for you. And I'm really glad, you know, to be honest with you, that this has happened to me at this stage in my life, where I am as a man, where I am as a father, and where I am, you know, as a husband and as a performer, as an artist. Because I think, you know, if this had hit when I was 23 instead of being 43, it would have been different. You know, I think I'm able to really sit back and really just enjoy the beauty of this moment, you know, and realize, yo, this may never come around again. And that's all good, because this has been so beautiful to be able to be on this show, Power Book 4 Force, with, you know, a good friend of mine, and make new friends and work with new artists and talented cats, and to have a show that is so loved by millions of people around the globe.
Right.
Around the globe. It's fantastic. And I really appreciate it. And I'm really just humbled by it and love this whole Power Book 4 Force experience.
I'm sure you are. We're loving watching it. So that's beautiful. We are so happy and so proud of you. We're proud of you like you're our cousin or something, like our Chicago cousin.
Yeah.
We're super proud of you and the whole cast, the whole crew. You guys are putting on an amazing show. And I just have to thank you again so much for giving your time to us today. This has been amazing.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me. I'll have to come back again and chop it up with y'all real soon. Maybe in season two. You know what I'm saying?
Let's do it.
Stay locked in.
Definitely. Thank you for coming on the show today, man. Thank you just for being you, man. Thank you.
Hey, man, my pleasure. Thank y'all for everything. Keep enjoying the show. You know, I know it goes without saying, but keep tuning in. You know, there's a lot more show left, and we got a lot more to give you as this story unfolds.
Yeah, definitely. Until next time, right?
Until next time, indeed.
Yeah. Hey guys, your sound is off. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
I know. I think they're guys. Yeah. You might be muted.
Hello.
There we go.
Yeah. Okay.
Can you hear me now? Good.
Can you hear me now?
Can you hear me now?
Good.
Yes. We were just saying again. Thank you so much, Anthony. And hopefully, we will talk to you soon, and we'll get you back on.
Indeed, y'all be good.
Appreciate your time.
You will.
Thank you.
Peace.
Peace.
Yeah.
Anthony Fleming III, ladies and gentlemen.
That's what it is. That's the legend, man. That's the man that brought a bat to the gunfight. That's a no-no in the city, let me tell you.
Hey, as you said, JP ain't got to do all that. He good with the bat because he's like that. Ooh, bars. Wait a minute. Did you hear that?
Freestyle Fridays.
Man, you with the pen.
Because JP is like
Freestyle
that.
Fridays.
Oh, God. You going to put you on the mic yet? Next.
No. I'm not ready for all that. I'm actually terrible at freestyle rapping.
Drop the beat.
No.
She's got some. She's got beats. I sent it to her this morning.
Okay. No, I'm not rapping on no beats, y'all. I'm not rapping on no beats. But
yeah, for sure. I mean, we could hit the sports minute. You know, we got top five coming up. What's up, guys? We got Freestyle Friday.
This is the artist.
Yeah, what's up?
What you feel like doing, Steve?
Let's do the sports minute. Sports minute with your boy here, only on the Midday Live Show.
All right, let's run that intro, Johnny.
What up, everybody? It's Steve Stylez, your boy, with another Sports Minute. So let's get it cracking with the video. Here we go. All right, we're talking about the Bulls, baby. The Bulls doing great things, big things. Man, that's a sweet layup. You know, we got the boys are back in business. The starters are back for you guys. And my question to everybody is, are we going to see them in the Eastern Conference Finals? Well, that question is going to be up to you. What I can tell you is that the Bulls, who were once in first place, are now coming down from a fourth place reback, meaning they got a few more spots left before they get ranked first in the Eastern Conference division. But with the way they played last night against Detroit, the faith is there. Look at this pass real quick. Outlet pass. Kobe, two, boom. Derek, bam, with the dunk. Very smooth. Look at that. Another replay again. Boom. Outlet pass. No outlet pass. Pass it to the point. Point to move. Back door. Dunk. There we go. Felt like we saw that same play three times. Anyway, Khalil Mack. Trade. All the way to the San Diego Chargers. So it's going to be kind of crazy. So, you know, this just means one thing, Bears fans. We are in a rebuilding stage. We got ourselves a new GM. Got ourselves a new coach. Got ourselves, you know, an amazing quarterback in Justin Fields. But we got the Chargers ready to land six-time Pro Bowler pass rusher Khalil Mack from the Bears. This breaks my heart because I thought he was going to be a Bear for life. But that's it. That's your Sports Minute with Steve Stylez.
Love to see it. Well, I mean, the Bulls have been really up and down lately. So I really hope that, you know, they get it together. But yeah, that's all I can really say on that.
That's cool. I think we got Big Jay. Here we go. Jay, what do you think about what? Oh, no, we'll get the headphones on. What do you think about the Bulls in the Eastern Conference Finals? If you could pick your top three teams in the Eastern Conference Finals, what would they be?
Right now?
Yeah.
Want
me to go first?
Miami hot right now?
Miami hot. Real hot.
I'll tell you the team that's not going nowhere. Brooklyn. It ain't hitting right now.
It ain't.
Milwaukee, y'all got to figure it out.
Because when they're on their own point, you know.
Who hitting? Who is hitting? Two teams in the East?
Yeah, two, three teams. That's good. If you got you two in Miami and Milwaukee, that's dope. I'm saying the Bulls.
In Chicago, for sure.
Yeah, it's going to be Chicago, for sure.
Yeah. We in that like gin here.
Most definitely. Lonzo come back. My other boy come back. LaVine come back.
Yep.
It's a wrap, bro. We running it this year. We could be Milwaukee.
Oh, we definitely can, man. We finally, we got a little big guy, you know, little big guy, Tristan Thompson. You know, we got him in the paint.
Yeah.
He out there yelling at them young boys.
Yeah.
That's
76ers and Bulls.
You know, I would have said that too. I would have said that a week ago, you know? With the way the Nets go, it's just bad timing, bad timing. What if we do 76ers, Bulls, Miami?
See, this is the thing with Brooklyn, right? You really don't know what's going on yet because Ben Simmons ain't played yet. I don't think Ben Simmons is going to help that team. I actually think it's worse.
Man, I don't know. Well, the good thing is he was on the bench for majority, and he went to that game on the bench, meaning that he's humble. He'll wait his turn because he's not like a star. It's been like, I need to play. Put me in top five. Nah, man. We got the top five here at the Midday Live Show. Don't worry about that later. Right. Yeah, but yeah, you know, he's got some point there. You know, I have no hope for Ben Simmons. You know, he seemed like a diva at Philadelphia.
I mean, yeah, he's definitely a diva, but I just don't feel like Brooklyn is the place for him at all. His best skill sets are like being a point guard and handling a ball, which we already have the best point guard in the NBA. And his second skill set would be a small forward, like wing position. And we have the best small forward wing player in the league. What is he going to do? Is he going to play defense? He going to block shots or be a rim protector? We don't have a spot for him.
We're good. I don't even know. He's like a Stromile Swift that could pass. I just took it back.
He's a 6'10 point guard that can't shoot.
Yeah, that's to say he can't shoot. But then we got all these videos online during practice. Practice is practice, not the game. That's all I'm saying. But that was your Sports Minute here on the Midday Live Show with your boy Steve Stylez.
All right, Steve Stylez. I think it's time we hop into the top five. We keeping it power related today because our top five is none other than 50 Cent himself.
You know it, guys. 50 Cent had plenty of bangers, but we pulled this from the staff here at the Midday Live Show. So without further ado, the first one is going to be Power, Powder, Respect with Jeremiah, 50 Cent. Who else am I forgetting on this?
Lil Durk.
The one and only voice.
Five, four, three, two, one.
Paper, yeah, I gotta stack that. Them diamonds keep blinking, we might have to jack that. Now, boy, when that blinky come out, you get clapped fast.
All right.
Hey, I just want to say, low-key, I think everybody thought the original Powers theme song was great, legendary, you know?
Yeah,
but I think Forrest might take the cake. That might take that number one spot because
smooth.
That theme song is a vibe, like 100%.
I don't know, man. I got so used to hearing the Power theme song, like I know the whole verse at this point. Oh, like it's kind of a thing.
It's a good thing.
It is a good thing. It's a good song.
I never took a straight path nowhere. I know the rest of it. See.
Excellent. Next on the list for our top five on the Midday Live Show is Hustler's Ambition.
5, 5, 4, 4, 3, 3, 2, 1.
Feelers. America got a thing for this gangsta shit. They love me. Black Chuckers, Black Scully, leather Pele Pele. I take spin over rainbow shit. I'm a fan who got that silver duct tape on my tray.
Yeah, love that one.
Oh yeah, that's a motivator.
That's the one that he ended a Get Rich or Die Trying performing, right? That's the one, yes. Right there. That's the one. That's in my memory, man.
That's what's up. Next on the list, guys, on the top five, we got Get In My Car.
5, 5, 4, 4, 3, 3, 2, 1.
I'm a straight gorilla with it, cold-hearted. With it, any getting out of line can get it. I make it hot, motherfuckers freeze up when I come through. 10:32, my snorkel. I might smile and say
what's up, but I don't. That's crazy, right? Now I'm gonna ask Jarrell real quick. Do you notice the picture I put up there?
Oh, you know
I. That's what he was over here giggling about.
hey, 50, you know, he the man with the microphone. You know, he the man on TV.
Yep.
But yo, let the athletics, you know what I'm saying, lead up to the athletes.
Get off, 50. Let him do him.
Well, how about this, Jazz? You ever see those memes when they have rappers pitching, you know, at baseball games? Nah?
Yes.
Look it up.
Yes.
There, you have? Mm-hmm. Gierbo comes to mind. You know what I'm saying? It's just...
I've seen that one.
Cool. Well, you know, I think shout out to 50. He's keeping it tradition.
Period.
Next on the list, only on the Midday Live Show, we got the top five where we take an artist and we break them down, staff choice. So if you stay tuned, you're going to listen to a couple more songs. This one is Down on Me.
5, 5, 4, 4, 3, 3, 2, 1.
Thumping, party jumping, shorty, she's a perfect 10. She rock her hips and roll her hips and drop it down like it's nothing. She just like an hourglass. You see how fast an hour pass. Time flies when I'm on that dead, but I won't put out this on blade. Work it like a pro sitting.
Pro.
Yeah, she bouncing fast, she shake it slow.
Yeah. Yeah, shout out Jeremiah.
Shout out Jeremiah. He went to my high school.
Oh man. Oh, that's what's up.
That's what's up. We're gonna get shout him on the Jeremiah. Show, I think.
Excuse me? I'm sorry, completely unrelated. So my phone died during the interview, right?
Okay.
Why didn't it just turn back on randomly?
Well, your phone was playing dead.
It was playing dead. I ain't never in my life had my phone play dead before.
Hey, this is Chicago.
What
hey.
Type of man, it's, back it's, to the top five, Steve. I'm sorry.
Yeah, here we go. Last one on the list. Baby by me, baby. Be a millionaire.
5, 5, 4, 4, 3, 3, 2, 1.
Yeah, then up back. Me, I'm a freak. I get into all that. Girl, I perform for you like a porno star. See, you had nothing. I just need a little bit more. New music, new mood, new position.
Oh, for sure. You definitely can vote, my man. You can hit us up directly. Follow us at The Midday Live Show on Instagram. Let us know. You know, follow us. You know, we follow back, and we'll give you the content you want to watch. Just tune in every Friday for The Midday Live Show.
Most definitely. Most definitely. Yeah, get those votes in, man. We love to hear it.
Oh, hell yeah.
We love suggestions from our listeners and our viewers. So definitely, if you have an artist you want to hear on the top five, the Midday Live top five, as you say, all you got to do is DM us, follow us on Instagram at The Midday Live Show or Twitter at Midday Live Show. And of course, like us on Facebook at The Midday Live Show.
Most definitely.
Send us a message.
We love the interaction, man. Yes. You know what I mean?
So big shout out to you, D, for listening. Appreciate that.
Yeah, definitely. We got a lot more left to go, you know, besides a quick shout out to our sponsors, you know, big ups to TDP, Rap-A-Lot Midwest, along with Monarch Clothing. Big shout out to Elijah in the basement. You know, they're going to be joining us shortly. And we appreciate every single listener. Now, if you hit the like button, you're definitely a supporter, definitely a sponsor, because, you know, our marketing team is you guys, you know. So hit the like button, share, maybe, you know, catch us on a podcast. Keywords are always going to be The Midday Live Show.
And you know what Jarrell's keyword is?
With the DM.
We're going to try to be that shining light, that beacon of hope. You know, what was that?
Oh, what I'm sorry. I forgot to turn the mic down, bro. I forgot to turn the mic down. My bad, dog. It just jumped out. I'm sorry, bro.
Hey, it's all good.
Jarrell's keywords are, it just jumped out.
It that's just jumped out.
That's four a lot of words.
Oh yeah, for sure. You guys ready for a final word?
Let's do it. Come on, here we final go. Word.
Yeah, definitely, guys. Once again, hit that like button if you liked the video so far. Subscribe if you want to get a new one every Friday here on the Midday Live Show. So let's break down this final word, guys. I may get a little loud.
Get loud.
All right. You gotta get messed up sometimes. You gotta get your feelings hurt. You gotta get disappointed in your life. You need people to tell you no. You're gonna go for gas. You're gonna go for get some loan or some money, and people are gonna tell you no. But what you're gonna do is just realize that's just a little dirt. You gotta get dirty sometimes. You gotta get dirt on yourself to develop. Dirt really isn't dirt. Think of it like fertilizer. Dirt is nutrients. Dirt is what's going to give you the resiliency not to give up. You know, for the seed to push through the soil and then grow. See, you get mad when haters come your way. You get mad at setback. You get mad because a family member may have passed away. You get upset, you get thrown off course, you get mad from a detour. You gotta realize it's just dirt. Show me something that hasn't grown into something beautiful that hasn't had to get a little bit of dirt on themselves. You know, so you gotta get that strength that comes from getting a little dirty. So it's okay to get a little dirty. Get a little dirt on your shoulder. Get a little dirt on your clothes. You know, and once you accept that, you'll really be able to grow. And you can't put a price on that growth. All right? That's the final word. It's your boy Steve Stylez.
It is. That's what it is. You can't grow without putting some dirt on it. You feel me?
Yes, sure. You need that sunshine. You need that hydration. You need all that in all aspects of life. You can't expect to grow without first building a foundation. Mm-hmm. Let's start there. And then, yeah, it's like you need those essentials that help you grow. So I think part of my final word would be just don't try to take on every single battle alone. Mm-hmm. Don't make it too personal. Like, I know it's tons of things that we all feel like we need to go through ourselves. For sure, by myself. I need to figure this out by myself. But at the same time, don't be afraid to ask for help, because sometimes you need that community behind you. You need, even if it's just one person, if your community is one person that supports you, that lifts you up when they know you need it, when you're down, rely on them. Don't always try to grow by yourself, because sometimes you need help and it's okay to ask for help. You got to grow, as D says. Definitely. You
got to
grow.
Got to grow. I like that comment. Yeah, that's what's up. You got to.
Jarrell, any final words for the people?
Hey, man, you know what it is, man. Stay dangerous. Hey, and make sure that you look good. Because when you look good, you feel good.
Feel good. You feel good. You play good. You play good. They pay good.
Cool. Okay. I don't know why I thought today was payday for a second.
No.
Oh, well. Next Friday.
Put in those hours while you can.
Right, okay. Put in those hours. Put in that work. I was about to talk about Kim Kardashian's comment for a second, but I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to go there. We're going to leave that for maybe the next episode or podcast or something.
Let's go, guys. Great show. Appreciate your
time. Absolutely. Big shout out to TDP, Trust the Process, Monarch Clothing. As you said, Elijah with The Basement Shy. Big shout out to Lynn Banks, owner of Icon Island, for joining us today. Make sure y'all follow her at Icon Island. She got all the marketing, the promotions, everything to do with music. She got the gym. She got the knowledge for you. And a big thank you to everybody over at STARZ that even made this possible. Thank you for bringing us Anthony Fleming III, the man, the myth, the legend himself. Us being from Chicago, that just really means a lot to us to be able to sit down and actually have a conversation with him. So big shout out to him. Make sure y'all follow him as well at Anthony Fleming III, RD as in third. And yeah, the Midday Live Show. That was another very, very good episode. I think we over and out.
That's what it is.
That's what it is. That's
you feel what it's me? Gonna be. Where you at on Instagram, Jazz? So tell them where you at.
Oh, of course. You can follow me on Instagram at JazzerSoFierce. I am dropping a new impression tonight, so make sure you stay tuned. Give me a follow. How about you, Steve?
Easy. At Steve_Stylez_again.
That's what it is, bro. You know the voice, you know the vibes. I'm on Twitter, Life of Jarrell. I'm on Instagram, Life of Jarrell. You can always catch me in your girl DMs. I'm always there. That's what it is.
Speaking on Twitter, you didn't follow me back. And I followed you like 3 months ago.
Man, you feel me? You gotta make my TL pop. You gotta make the cut.
All right, y'all. It has been a wonderful day. Make sure you guys stay warm out there. Stay safe in these Chicago streets. And the Midday Live Show will be back next week with two more very special guests for episode 20. Y'all have a good one. Yeah.